Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends, in this video we are going to see the functional block diagram of a microprocessor. So microprocessor, the best example of microprocessor is a 8085 is the best example can be given for the microprocessor. First we are going to see what is the general block diagram of a microprocessor, and then we will see each and every block and its specification for microprocessor. So in functional block diagram, as you can see in the block diagram, it consists of a clock, CPU, then it has a 3 bus and 3 devices. In 3 buses, you have a data bus, address bus and control bus. Every device requires a clock pulses to be provided so that the device or that block can be worked according to the clock pulses. So the clock is provided to the microprocessor and different data buses are connected. In that you can see data bus is a bi-directional. Now why it is a bi-directional? Because the data should be fetched and data can be provided. That means read and write, this both the operation can be taken place from over a data. So for that purpose data bus is a bi-directional, whereas address bus and control bus are unidirectional. Now apart from this, we have 3 different blocks are connected to it, and those are external peripherals. That means if you are connecting any external device from where the data can be fetched and execute a task on that data, or data can be provided to the external device connected to it. So it consists of, it is known as an external peripheral. Then you have a input resources. Now you have a different types of input resources from where the data can be taken to processed. Then you have a memory. Now if you are processing a data, that means the data before processing and after processing, it should be stored somewhere. So to storage, you need to have memory. So you have a different memory locations in a microprocessor. So basically memory locations are known as a register arrays or register pairs where we store a data. So this is called as a memory. So according to the function or according to the function block diagram of a microprocessor, it can have a different types of memory locations. So in this video we are going to see how many different memory locations are possible, what can be a different external peripherals available to the microprocessor, how data bus, address bus, control bus can be work, how data can be fetched and it can be processed, and how internal resources can be utilized. Now in microprocessor 8085, it is called as a 8-bit microprocessor. Now why it is known as a 8-bit microprocessor? I have already explained you in the previous video that if the number of bits processed in that one instruction, that will decide the type of processor. So that means in 1 second, it is processing 8-bit of data. And it is also depend on the data bus available for that particular microprocessor. So if you take the example of 8085 or 8085, it has 8-bit data bus, where data bus is dedicated from AD0 to AD7. Now you will realize what is AD0 and AD7 when you look at the pin diagram of 8085, that we will see later on. But AD0 to AD7, these are dedicated for a data bus, and data bus, 8 lines of a data bus and 8 lines of an address bus are multiplexed together, and those can be utilized. And address bus, it provide you the 16 bits of address bus. 8085 microprocessor has 16 bits of address bus. That means it can provide you the memory location 2 raised to 16. That is 2 raised to 16 is equal to 65536. So this number of bits can be stored, that is nothing but 64 kilobytes of memory locations are available in an 8085 microprocessor, which can be utilized to store a data. That means data can be stored any one memory location out of the 64 KB memory locations. So that is the feature of 8085. So address bus are available from pin number A0 to A15. So if you count from A0 to A15, these are nothing but 16 parallel lines connected. So address bus is nothing but it's a parallel lines or wires connected which can be utilized, that bus can be utilized to provide that particular memory location address to that device or to microprocessor, so that microprocessor will come to know where exactly the data is located and from where I have to fetch the data. That is why the memory locations and address bus is required. Along with address bus and data bus, it consists of a different interrupt. Those are called as an external interrupt. Now, what is the use of an interrupt? If there is some task is in a process and if any other problem is arise, then before executing that particular task, if you want to finish the problem or to resolve the problem, then interrupt is used. That means interrupt is a process which is used to interrupt the ongoing process or ongoing task. So first processor has to resolve what is the interruption is or what is the issue is, and then it can again jump to executing the task. So we have two different external interrupt available. So in that we have one 16 bit stack pointer, which is also denoted by SP, and 16 bit program counter, which is denoted by PC. So these are the two different external interrupts available. We here have pin diagram of 8085. As I explain you, it has two different clock cycle. You can see two pins denoted by X, and those are used to provide a clock pulses. Then you have a different operations that are read, write and control. Then you have address bus and data bus. If you observe carefully, in first A0 till A7, you have AD0 to AD7. That means this 8 pins can be available for an address bus as well as a data bus. So this 8 pins are multiplexed. So when it is an address bus, it can be denoted from A0 to A7. But if you are using it as a data bus, then it can be utilized as a D0 to D7. And the remaining A8 to A15 can also be used for the address bus purpose. Then you have many different inputs like RST 5.5, RST 7.5 trap. These are nothing but the external interrupt. This can be utilized to interrupt the ongoing process. Then you have hold, you have a VCC, VSS. So it requires a single 5 volt supply that can be given to the VCC, and it works on a clock frequency of 3.2 megahertz. That is a one single clock phase supply is given, and on that the operation takes place. So as we have seen the pin diagram, it was given there that it requires a plus 5 volt single supply and it works on a 3.2 megahertz clock frequency. It has a different type of a memory location. It has a stack memory, it has a program memory, it has a data memory. And then we are seeing if it is having 16 bit address bus, that means 2 raised to 16, that is equal to 65,536 memory locations are available. In this 64 KB memory locations, data can be stored anywhere where the data bus can control from any memory location. It can jump, it can fetch, it can branch, it can take the branch operations anywhere from the 64 kilobytes memory location. So that is a huge memory location is available to store the data in a microprocessor. Then it has a stack memory. Stack memory is it increases downwards. So stack memory can be used for a specific purpose when you want to store a data. So data can be stored in this memory location, and for that the registers arrays are required. And we have different register array which are 8 bits long. So the six major registers we have, that is BC. So it can work in pair or they can work individually. So BC, DE and HL. This pair can be utilized if the data requirement is a 16 bit, but if you want to work on a data of a 8 bit data, then you can go for a single register. Similarly, you have an accumulator where data can be stored. This is a default memory location where data is stored after performing a different task. For example, if you are having a two numbers and you are adding a two numbers, after addition, the result of that particular operation can be stored in an accumulator. So accumulator is a special purpose register where data can be stored. Similarly, we can see that we have a general purpose register, we have a special purpose register. So we will see what kind of registers we have. So here we have a register section. You can see in the diagram that different D flip-flop. Now these are the same D flip-flops, those are connected together where data can be inserted and data can be taken out. So this configuration is a parallel in, parallel out, where the data is provided in a parallel manner. So input is connected for each and every D block consist in a diagram, and accordingly output of each and every D flip-flop can be taken. So these are the flip-flop. As we know that D flip-flop can store one bit, and it stands for a delay flip-flop. That means if data is stored according to the clock frequency or the clock pulses, at the negative going edge of the clock, the data is produced as an output. So when data is inserted and till the clock frequency goes negative, the data is remained stored in a D flip-flop, and then after that delay time, you get the output. So that is D flip-flop stands for. So here D flip-flop is used. One D flip-flop will store one bit of information. So number of bit we processed in 8085 is 8 bit, so we required 8 flip-flop should be connected together. So in this diagram we have 8 flip-flop connected together, and they will work in a parallel in and parallel out manner. Now organization of these registers will decide the time required, or you can say execution time of a program, and what is the simplicity of a program. So this can be decided on the organization. So we have a serial in, serial out. We have a serial in, parallel out. Parallel in, serial out. Right shift, left shift. These are many types of organization are available to connect the different flip-flop to form a register, so that the word length can be stored. So here we have a parallel in and parallel out. So number of registers should be available in either 8-bit or 16-bit. If it you want 8-bit register to be available, then you can go for an individual like B, register C, register H, register D, E and L. These are the different registers available. If a single, then it process only 8-bit data. But if you want to process a 16-bit data, then you have to work with a pair of the register. And this pair can be BC, DE or HL. So three pairs of registers are available if you want to process a 16-bit data. Now this is the same what we have talked about the register. You have a temporary register, you have a special purpose register, and you have a general purpose register. So in general purpose register, we have a BC, DE and HL. So it holds at a time 8-bit data. If working in a pair, then it holds a 16-bit data. Special purpose register is, you can talk about the accumulator. After performing a task, a data can be stored in an accumulator for a temporary purpose. Then you can shift that data in the register pair where you want to store the data. So we have already seen what is arithmetic and logical unit is. So basically it performs mathematical operations and logical operations. So in digital signals and digital logic systems, the module 4 when we have studied, we have learned what is logical system is. Now computer, when we talk about the computer, it works on a processor. That means it should work in a manner what the processor can understand. So when it is a digital communication, and digital communication is always in a ones and zeros manner. So when the data is in ones and zeros, and the device used to process that data is called as a digital device, and we also called it as a logical device, because logic levels are nothing but 0 and 1. 1 can be considered as a high and 0 can be considered as a low. So this arithmetic and logic unit can be used to perform operations like addition, subtraction, integration. Then you can perform ANDing, ORing, XORing. So ANDing, ORing and XORing are nothing but these are logic level operations where you can use the basic logic gates to perform the operation on the binary data, where binary data can be represented in the terms of ones and zero. So ALU can take the data from the different memory locations available in a computer, or the input output devices which are connected to the computer. Then that data can be processed and output can be stored in a different data format. And this can be binary data format, this can be BCD data format. So basically the processing of different types of data format can be done by using arithmetic and logical unit. Next is a data bus. Data bus can be, it is a 8 line, 16 line or 32 line, depending on the data bus available, that microprocessor can be categorized as a 8-bit data bus, 16-bit or the 32-bit. So in 8085, 8 data bits, data lines are available. So it is called as an 8-bit microprocessor. So AD0 to AD7, these 8 lines can be utilized as a data bus. Data bus lines can be merged, or you can say multiplex with an address bus, then it can be called as a AD0 to AD7. So data bus is a bidirectional. Why bidirectional data bus is required? Because it can read the data or it can write the data. It can read the data, that means if any external device is connected to the computer, when the data bus is giving the read operation, that means the device is ready to read the data. So that time microprocessor will read the data from that particular device, and when it wants to change something in that particular data, then it has to write. So microprocessor will get the instruction to write a particular content in that particular device. So it can take, read and write a data from memory locations which are internally available, or it can take from IO devices, where IO devices stands for input or output devices. That's why it is a bi-directional data bus, and it can be multiplexed with a address line. So you have a different data bus, that means you have a 64 kilobyte of memory locations where you can store a data and from where you can fetch the data. Next slide is address bus. We all know that address bus is of 16 bits. 16 bit is nothing but 2 raised to 16, and it will provide you the 64 kilobytes of address locations. Address is a unidirectional because address can be only provided. That means if microprocessor wants to perform something, that means, for example, let's take an example that microprocessor wants to perform a logical operation, and for that it requires some data. So it knows that it has to know that where the data is located. In out of 64 memory location where the data is stored, so that memory location has to be forwarded to the microprocessor so that microprocessor can fetch data from that particular micro memory locations. So that microprocessor can be fetched data from that particular memory location. So that memory location is nothing but it is called as a memory address. And this address has to be provided to the microprocessor by using address bus. So address is nothing but it is always provided to the microprocessor. It don't need to revert back to that memory location. So it is a unidirectional. Data, what it has to be fetched and it has to be stored. That means it's a two-way process. Data can be taken and it can be stored. So it is a bi-directional. But when it comes to the address, address can be only provided to the microprocessor so that the exact location of that particular data can be known. So it is a unidirectional. So we have 64 kilobytes of memory locations of which address can be shared with a microprocessor. Next is a control bus. Control bus is to control the operation which is taking place on a data. For example, it can control read action, write action and fetch action. Fetch, that means if you want to execute any program, then you have to fetch the data from a memory location. If you want to read something, if the control operation is a read, that means you have to read any particular device connected to the computer, or you have to read that particular memory location. If you want to write, the control signal is write, that means microprocessor has to write something on the document which can be connected to the input or output external peripheral, or it can be an internal memory location. So these are the control signals which can be given to the microprocessor so that microprocessor will come to know what should be done with that particular data or with that particular device. So this is what we called as a control bus, and control bus is of 8 bits. So in 8085, 8 bits control bus is available. It is also unidirectional, the control can be sent, that means control signal can be sent to the microprocessor, so it's a unidirectional. You no need to keep a two-way process for the control buses. Here is the description of a pin diagram which we have seen for 8085. So three major operations takes place is that read, write and ALE. When the instruction or the control signal read is given, that means the IO device or the memory location is ready to read. So data which is available on data bus has to be read by the microprocessor. When the write as a control signal is given, that means the data available on the database has to be right somewhere, and this somewhere is nothing but it can be a memory location or it can be other external input devices. So for example, if data bus is carrying a data, so when the write instruction is given, that means that particular data has to be written in a document which is located in an internal memory location, or the document which is located in an output device which is connected to the computer. Then you have an ALE. ALE is a pulse which is generated. It's a positive going pulse which is generated when the new task is started by the microprocessor. So when it is high, when ALE pulse is high, it indicates the read data or it indicates the address, and when ALE goes low, then it indicates the data. Accordingly, you have IO/M and S1 and S0. IO/M, it indicates whether it is input output device or whether it is a memory location. So whenever this pulse, whenever this pin goes high, then it indicates that it's an input output device. But whenever it goes low, when pin is low, then it indicates that it's a memory location. That means that particular operation to be performed with the memory location if it is low. Similarly, S1 and S0, the high and low of this pin will decide what is the current execution, what is the current status of the program. So these are the different types of characteristics we need to understand about the microprocessor before we use the microprocessor for some kind of application. I hope you have understood the block diagram of a microprocessor, the example which we have taken as a 8085, and how address bus, data bus, all these blocks work together to perform different type of application. Thank you for watching this video. Stay tuned to eKida. Do subscribe eKida. Thank you so much.